cries, prepare in the desert a way for Yahweh. Make a straight highway for our God across the wastelands. Let every valley be filled in, every mountain and hill be leveled, every cliff become a plateau, every escarpment a plain. Then the glory of Yahweh will be revealed, and all humanity will see it together. For the mouth of Yahweh has spoken. In the nature of prophecy, as we understand it, that would have meant something to the people of the time when Isaiah spoke these words to them. But of course, for us, it's become inextricably linked with the preparation for Christmas, what we call the time of Advent. But it must have meant something very special, I think, to John the Baptist, because it had such an influence on him that I think he built his life. He certainly built his ministry on this idea. And the inspired genius of John enabled him to see something in this, perhaps, that nobody else had ever seen. That the picture we get from the Old Testament was that under the Old Covenant, God dealt with the people of Israel as an entity. They were the chosen people, the chosen race. But the genius of John, inspired by God, enabled him to see that this new covenant that God was announcing through him was very different. God was now dealing with the individual. And that surely expressed in the idea of baptism, which John said was essential in order to enter into this or be prepared for this new covenant that God was bringing into being. Now it's personal. It's between you and God. And surely Jesus endorses that to the full when, much to John's surprise and amazement and reluctance, let it be said, Jesus asks John to baptize him in the Jordan. So this is personal, friends. This is between you as an individual and God. But obviously, it brings us all together in the community, the fellowship of those who are in covenant with our God and share their lives with him and share in his work. So our first hymn, I think, continues this idea of this is personal, this is individual, this is between me and God. I love this hymn, not least because every time I think about it, I'm reminded of that part of the Monty Python film, The Life of Brian, when the revolutionary group are together and they're trying to gee themselves up into a fervor of hatred against Rome. And they're saying, what have the Romans ever done for us? And they realize that the Romans have done quite a lot, in actual fact. But I can imagine the writer of this hymn sitting down, I want to praise God. Why do I want to praise God? What's God ever done for me? Ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven? No wonder I want to praise God. And of course, the praise that God asks of us more than anything else is the praise that expresses itself in telling other people how wonderful he is. So it's number 466. Praise my soul, the King of heaven. To his feet thy tribute bring. Thank you. No wonder then that we share with the poet a desire to praise God because of our experience of him, our personal experience of him, because of our personal relationship with him. Echoes the words of Isaiah again. He uses the ancient Hebrew name for God, the most precious of Hebrew names for God, Yahweh, which I say everywhere I go in this circuit. People will be getting fed up of hearing it, but it is. I keep repeating it because it's true. The one who can be trusted. And it's on that basis then that God invites us to enter into covenant with him. Our experience of that faithfulness inspires us that we should do no less than renew that covenant with him for the coming year. So let's pray to this God of ours. Father God, we thank you that our experience of you, as with generations who have gone before us, is indeed that you are the God who can be trusted. You are the God who wants to be in fellowship, in communion, in covenant with his people. People whom he has made in his the image and likeness, so that that relationship can be enjoyed, and through it we can become everything that your love plans for us to be. We recognize that because of who you are, it was absolutely necessary and essential that Jesus should come as a human being and live amongst us, revealing the truth concerning you, revealing your attitude towards us and the plans and purposes that your love extends to us, but also in and through his living among us, he should reveal the truth about human life, what it can become, what its potential is. And so we thank you that these two amazing things are joined together in him. Let us never lose sight, never let our sense of awe and wonder diminish at this expression of your love for us, your concern for us, your commitment toward us. And so, as those who have gone before us, our parents, if you like, in the faith, have done through the generations, we come to renew our commitment to you, sure and certain of your continuing commitment to us. So may these things come together in this time that we share this morning. May they be expressed in every aspect of the life that we will share together in the days that lie ahead, as we, by your grace and through your power, respond to the challenges and opportunities which the proclamation of the good news will bring to us. We pray this especially at this time of transition and change in the life of our church communities. May we be assured that your hand is upon these things. May we do these things that will be able you enable you to bless us to the extent that we want, in order that we can go and be a blessing to others. Above all, we thank you that we can ask these things, as all things, in and through the name of Jesus and for the sake of his kingdom here among us. Amen. So we'll listen now to our reading from the scriptures, please.
The reading is taken from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Jesus was born in the town of Bethlehem in Judea during the time when Herod was the king. Soon afterwards, some men who studied the stars came from the east to Jerusalem, and they asked, "Where is the baby born to be the king of the Jews? We saw his star when it came up in the east, and we have come to worship him. When King Herod heard about this, he was very upset, and so was everybody else in Jerusalem. He called together all the chief priests and the teachers of the law, and he asked them, "Where will the Messiah be born?" "In the town of Bethlehem in Judea," they answered, "for this is what the prophet wrote. Bethlehem, in the land of Judea, you are by no means the least of the leading cities of Judah. From you will come a leader who will guide my people Israel." So Herod called the visitors from the east to a secret meeting and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem with these instructions: "Go and make a careful search for the child, and when you find him, let me know, so that I too can go and worship him." And so they left, and on their way they saw the same star they had seen in the east. When they saw it, how happy they were! What joy was theirs! It went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. They went into the house, and when they saw the child with his mother Mary, they knelt down and worshipped him. They brought out their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and presented them to him. Then they returned to their country by another road, since God had warned them in a dream not to go back to Herod. Thanks be to God.
We think around those words, we'll sing again. This time it's the song number 54. When I was looking at this in preparation for this morning, it just struck me how fast things have moved on. I'm not entirely sure when this was written, but the form you have here is rather different from the one I was expecting and the one that I'm used to. The sort of later version, I suppose, has been sort of got at by the inclusivity police, if you like. And the first line now is, "Brother, sister, let me serve you." A bit of practical equality for us. So you, if you wish, may choose to sing the updated verse by the words. I leave it to you. "Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you."
Thank you.
I was thinking the other day when I was preparing for this morning, and it suddenly struck me that the only proof that Jesus is who and what he claimed to be is you and me. That's the only proof that there is. Because I guess the ultimate claim of Jesus was that people who put their trust in him, who believed in him, that he was the truth about God and humanity, they would know life in all its fullness. So it's the extent to which we live this life in all its fullness and make it visible to the world around us that is the only proof, as I say, of who and what Jesus claimed to be. You are my witnesses. You are my proof. You are my evidence. And the fellowship that we enjoy together as the body of Christ, making his presence real in the world today, is the only proof of that. Sobering thought, isn't it? But now that a talking carrot and an insect-eating plant, what on earth was that about? Did you get that? I didn't. Now that they've stopped telling us about where the perfect Christmas can be bought with their invitation to come and spend, the gospel passage I'd like us to think about this morning reminds us of what for me is the central message of the Christmas stories, that God says through them, come and see, come and see, come and see what I've done for you. Come and see the gift I want to give you in Jesus Christ. And that seems appropriate, doesn't it, for this Covenant Sunday, which we're observing for today. Because for us, the story of Epiphany is inextricably linked with our celebration of Christmas. It's enshrined, isn't it, in our nativity plays. And it's become invested with all manner of myth and legend. So over and above the biblical record, we now have what are supposed to be the names of the three wise men, what they were like, the details of who gave which gift to the infant Jesus, and so on. Because the story is so familiar to us, it's received such embellishment. We tend to forget, perhaps, that when we strip all of this away, we are left with a truth which helps us in our understanding of covenant. I think we're reminded of the human, universal need for something, someone who is worthy of our allegiance, to whom we can commit our lives. This is surely an expression of a deeper need for something which gives life meaning and purpose. Ultimately, I suppose it's seeking to answer the question, why am I here? What is life for? Clearly, millennia of history proved to us that this is a need which cannot be met from within ourselves. Similarly, it cannot be met in something external to ourselves, which we can discover for ourselves. It needs can only come as revelation from God. And this isn't some esoteric intellectual debate carried on within the rarefied atmosphere of the halls of academe. This is part of the very air that we breathe. O God, we are made for your possession, and our souls are restless until we find our peace in you. Surely this is part of what it means to be made in the image and likeness of God. This is why the wise men searched the heavens. suggested in this story seems to be that into the everyday life of every single human being, there comes God's offer of the answer, the fulfillment of this universal need. His invitation to come and see what he offers us in Jesus. His invitation is said to enter into covenant with him, not simply for our sake, but for his sake as well. It's what the posh word, I think, is symbiotic, isn't it? That both parties benefit from the arrangement. It benefits us, of course, but also it benefits God, that God needs us to continue the work begun in Jesus, to show the world around us how life should be lived. We are to teach the world how to live. And in this, we are enabled to personally possess the answer to this universal question, which we've talked about, with the accompanying blessings, but also, of course, to play our intended part in the eternal purposes of God. This seems to be an ever-present reality, but it seems to peak in certain times in history. Events around the time of the birth of Jesus meant that there was a wide-ranging atmosphere of expectation and anticipation that something was going to happen. In our time, with the state of the world that it is, there seems to be a pretty universal feeling that something needs to happen. There is a need for the church, for individual Christians, for those whose lives are lived in covenant with God as a result of responding to the invitation to us to come and see, to be issuing this invitation to others. I think we need to hear again the lessons which are contained within this story of the wise men. Firstly, I think we need to take a warning from the actions of these wise men in response to God's invitation, which was in their case to go to Jerusalem, to Herod's palace. In other words, their response to divine revelation was expressed in purely human terms and expectation. Strikes me that you didn't need to be particularly wise to know that heirs to thrones, those who are intended to become kings, have a tendency to be born in palaces. That's not exactly a revelation, is it? They knew that. It was to those who inhabited such places of power and influence and authority that these people were used to dealing with. They knew all that. The Magi apparently acted as advisors and counselors to those who lived in palaces. That was the kind of world to which they were used. That was the environment in which they operated. They were presumably familiar with this themselves and maybe have acted for rulers and people in power in a personal capacity in their lives and in their works. So perhaps the warning for us in all this is in connection with the temptation to bring the ways, standards and values of the world into the church. What I'm thinking of here is what seems to have been a growing belief in recent years, that the adoption of activities which perhaps can collectively be described as the social gospel is sufficient for the church to feel that it's fulfilling its great commission to go and make disciples of all nations. We've seen a proliferation of clubs and groups, social activities, good works, most recently and perhaps most lamentably. the need for food banks and warm places. These are the kind of things that I'm thinking about, and there's no doubt that they are of themselves worthy and worthwhile. Many of them fulfill those criteria in terms of perhaps getting people across the threshold of church premises. Bums on seats, as we used to call it. But at best, they can only ever be a means to an end and not ends in themselves. I remember a conversation I had with a previous chair of district. I remember it because I didn't tend to move in those kind of circles, so it was pretty much unique in my experience. I think she must have backed me into a corner on one of the rare occasions when I went to synod. But anyway, I remember her words quite clearly. We were talking around this kind of subject. And she was saying, you're never going to get people into the kingdom of God simply by offering them cheap cups of coffee. It has to go a bit further than that. And I was reminded of the story of dear old Nicodemus, this saintly character, we get the impression, sort of invited Jesus along so they could have a cosy chat about this, that, and the other. And Nicodemus got the shock of his life, didn't he? What did Jesus say to him? You must be born again. You must be born again. And that's as true today as it ever was. You must be born again in order that you can experience the kingdom of God for yourself. So these things, as I say, many of them worthy in their own right, have to be accompanied by or lead to a proclamation of the expression of which is at the heart of Jesus' ministry. Repent and believe the good news. We need to start talking about sin again, friends. Not in the sense of the bad things that it can lead people to do, but that is doubtless true. But in the sense that the consequence of not living your life in fellowship with God is to lead a diminished life. This needs to be backed up by the witness of the church and by the lives of individual Christians as to the difference the differences which enter into such a relationship with God make to life. We're reminded of the reason for the existence of the church, to play its part in God's eternal plan to reconcile the whole of creation to himself in Jesus. The whole point of this part of the story is that the wise men, the Magi, were not led to Jerusalem, to Herod's palace by the star. They went there on their own initiative. They went there because of their application to the situation, of their understanding of how things worked. They simply applied human wisdom and knowledge. St. Paul has some quite interesting things to say about this phenomenon, the existence of human wisdom and knowledge compared with that of God. Writing to the Christians in Corinth, he says, I am going to destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of any who say they understand. Where are the philosophers? Where are the experts? And where are the debaters of this age? Do you not see how God has shown up human wisdom as folly? Perhaps they weren't aware that this star was intended to be a means of guidance, as well as a sign that something amazing had happened. If they had been, they could have saved an awful lot of people a whole lot of trouble, couldn't they? Because true to tell, they nearly messed up the whole thing at the very beginning. But they put Jesus and the whole of God's offering to man in Jesus at risk because they relied on human wisdom rather than allowing divine wisdom to play its part. But in any event, they got it spectacularly wrong, didn't they? They ended up in completely the wrong place because they acted on their own initiative rather than looking for God's guidance. But we have to say, to their credit, their willingness to respond to God's invitation, their enthusiasm and willingness to embark on the journey required in order to see if what had happened would satisfy their need for truth, for meaning and purpose in life. And so they arrive in Jerusalem at Herod's palace to find that the world which they thought they knew and understood, from which they expected to find help in their searching, couldn't provide the answer. It's quite interesting, isn't it, how their enthusiasm and commitment, albeit somewhat misplaced, enables God to lead them on to the place that he wanted them to be, the place where he knew they needed to be. When human resources have failed to come up with answers, there is always recourse to the divine. They're introduced to the scriptures of the religion of Israel, the written word of God. From this, they learn that there is an eternal plan to bring about the purposes of God for his creation, the covenant which he has made with the people of Israel in order that they can play their part in this, and that they, the Magi, have become caught up in all of this as a result of their responding to the invitation which God has made to them. This invitation which, as we say, God issues to all people. The written word of God leads them, guides them to the word made flesh. It's from this point on that they are led to Jesus by the star. So what is being stressed here surely is the importance of the study of the scriptures. The scriptures are an essential tool that God has provided for us to enable us to be led to Jesus and as a consequence be better able to lead others to him. This is a vital part, isn't it, of the covenant relationship which God invites us to share with him and with each other. It's an essential part, dear friends, of being the church, because without it we are not truly the church. Not just study as individuals or couples or families. When all the chief priests and the scribes came together in Herod's palace, when they combined their learning, experience, knowledge, insights, scripture spoke and guided those who were seeking help as they embarked on the next phase of their journey to Jesus. When I read this for the umpteenth time in preparation for this morning, it suddenly struck me, why on earth didn't the religious leaders say to the wise men, we'll come with you, we'll guide you, we know where Bethlehem is, we'll take you, come along with us. But no, they didn't. They didn't make any offer of the kind. No wonder Jesus despaired of them. These were the people who had the knowledge, the information. They were the ones who studied the scriptures and interpreted them for the people for whom they were supposed to be the spiritual guides. They had the knowledge, but they didn't have the wisdom. They're not the same thing. Wisdom enables us to use knowledge. God's wisdom enables us to use knowledge of God in order to further the purposes of God. So this is the basis upon which we, as the church, the covenant people of God, should meet together in order to share our experiences, insights, knowledge. Each of us has this contribution to make. This is one of the ways in which we can build each other up. And the upshot is that the Magi are opened up to the truth of God and his will and purpose, and the possibility of divine guidance, being led to Jesus. And they're led to a place, as we know, in stark contrast to what their own expectations had imagined. With all that this has to say about the truth that God's ways are not our ways, God's thoughts are not our thoughts. Despite all the unlikelihood of this, these men give to Jesus the gifts which they had prepared for this king who was being born into the world. It always makes me smile when I see the nativity plays at school. My own eldest grandson was in one. He played with great distinction a camel. But the wise men come in, don't they, holding their gifts before them, and they present them to the infant Jesus and lay them at the foot of the crib. But if you look carefully at the story in the scriptures, it doesn't say that at all. They go into the stable, and after a while they emerge from the stable, they get their gifts, and then they take them back and they present them with Jesus. In other words, it wasn't until they were satisfied with what they found in this most unlikely of environments that they were prepared to give the gifts which they had brought. Presumably, when they went in to meet Herod, they would have carried their gifts before them. Imagine the embarrassment. Oh dear, we've come to the wrong place. These gifts really aren't for you. We'll have to take them back. Ever so sorry. Right. But surely what that says to us, to you and to me, be careful. Be careful about who and to what you give the gift of yourself, because that is the most precious thing that you possess. Don't give yourself to those things which worldly standards and values would suggest that you should. Rather, give them to God. So the wise men were satisfied, despite the probable disquiet which they experienced when they pitched up at that scruffy stable in that non-entity of a town. They were satisfied, despite their better judgment, maybe, that all that God was offering in his invitation had been met in these unpromising circumstances. So what I wonder was the final piece of the jigsaw. What was it that tipped them over the edge and decided that yes, they were in the right place? Obviously, we're not party to what went on in that stable, but it's quite reasonable to assume, isn't it, that Joseph and Mary spoke of their experiences of God. Not just the events which had led to the birth of Jesus, but maybe their whole life experience of life lived with God, because we know, we are told, that they were chosen by God for his purposes because they were devout. They gave their testimony. When was the last time I gave my testimony? When was the last time you spoke to someone about your experiences of God and his effect on your life? The story the experience of Christians throughout the generations who've made this journey in spirit to the same end result, surely encourage us to submit afresh to the kingship of Jesus and make him Lord of our lives. And this we do as we enter into this period of our worship, when we renew our covenant with our God and commit ourselves afresh to his purposes and the works of his kingdom. The personal nature of this is expressed in the next song that we're going to share together. I will offer up my life in spirit and truth. So we come to the words of the, which we'll use to renew our covenant with God, and a bit of a preamble to explain the background to this. God made a covenant with the people of Israel, calling them to be a holy nation, chosen to bear witness to his steadfast love by finding delight in the law. The covenant was renewed in Jesus Christ, our Lord, in his life, work, death, and resurrection. In him, all people may be set free from sin and its power, and united in love and obedience. In this covenant, God promises us new life in Christ. For our part, we promise to live no longer for ourselves, but for God. We make, therefore, as generations have met before us, to renew the covenant which bound them and binds us to God. Let us then seek forgiveness for the sin by which we have denied God's claim upon us. Sisters and brothers in Christ, let us again accept our place within this covenant, which God has made with us and with all who are called to be Christ's disciples. This means that by the help of the Holy Spirit, we accept God's purpose for us and the call to love and serve God in all our life and work. Christ has many services to be done. Some are easy, others are difficult. Some bring honour, others bring reproach. Some are suitable to our natural inclinations and material interests, others are contrary to both. In some we may please Christ and please ourselves. In others we cannot please Christ except by denying ourselves. Yet the power to do all these things is given to us in Christ, who strengthens us. Therefore, let us make this covenant of God our own. Let us give ourselves to him, trusting in his promises and relying on his grace. So from here on in, we will say these words together. Eternal God, in your faithful and enduring love, you call us to share in your gracious covenant in Jesus Christ. In obedience, we hear and accept your commands. In love, we seek to do your perfect will. With joy, we offer ourselves anew to you. We are no longer our own, but yours. I am no longer my own, but yours. Your will, not mine, be done in all things. Wherever you may place me, in all that I do, and in all that I may endure, when there is work for me, and when there is none, when I am troubled, and when I am at peace, your will be done. When I am valued and when I am disregarded, when I find fulfillment and when it is lacking, when I have all things and when I have nothing, I willingly offer all I have and am to serve you, as and where you choose. Glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours. May it be so forever. Let this covenant now made on earth be fulfilled in heaven. Amen. And amen. So we move to that symbol of our unity with God in Christ, our unity with each other. The Lord has made an everlasting covenant of peace with his people. Peace of the Lord be always with you, and also with you. We offer those around us a sign of the peace of God. Peace be with you. Thanks for your help. Peace be with you. It's a nice warm hand. Peace be near the radiator. Peace. Yes, Lydia. I know. Peace be with you. I know. Peace be with you. So we remember the context for this sharing, which Jesus commends to us, has its origins in the Passover meal, which was celebrated by families, as memory serves, in Israel. It involved a heck of a lot of symbolism because it had to do with God's actions in freeing the people from slavery in Egypt and beginning that journey to the promised land where his kingdom of Israel would be set up. The tradition was apparently that the youngest person in the gathering would ask questions in order that the explanation of the origins of the feast and the meaning of the symbols could be rehearsed for everyone, so that the tradition would carry on through the generations, because this was the most important event that had ever happened to the people of Israel in their history. But towards the end of that ceremony, Jesus does something dramatic, something which points up the fact that God in him and through him is doing something new. There's going to be a new covenant. Jesus almost seems to be saying, we've acknowledged, we've done justice, we've done reverence to the lessons of the past, the actions of God towards his people in the past. But from now on, you will never have to do that again. I am instituting something new. And instead of it, by implication, involving the whole nation of Israel as a collective, it was now personal. It was now directly between Jesus and the individual to whom he gave the symbols of himself. It's personal. It's between us as an individual and Jesus. God, our Father, fountain of goodness, creator of all that is, you have made us in your own image. You have given us life and reason and love for one another, setting in our hearts a hunger for you. In the darkness, you are our light. In adversity and temptation, our strength. You bear patiently with our folly and sin, granting us your law to guide us and your prophets to renew our faith. In the fullness of time, you came to us in love and mercy in Jesus Christ, your living word, full of grace and truth. He lived among us, declaring your forgiveness and revealing your wisdom in works of mercy and in his word of power. For us, he suffered and died upon the cross, by death destroying death. You raised him from the dead and exalted him to your right hand on high. Through him, you sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and light of your people, gathered together in every time and place to glorify your holy name. With them and all the company of heaven, we join in the unending hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. So as we individually and personally and yet collectively receive these symbols which remind us of the work and witness of Jesus, we say together the words of the family prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So today we're receiving communion in the pews, which I guess is very symbolic as we remember this Christmas season, that God comes to us. God always acts first. So as I understand it, when you receive the bread, you consume that right away, please, as a symbol that you have a personal relationship with God. But then with the wine, we will reserve that and consume it together to remind us that that individual relationship but brings us together in the fellowship of God's people in this place. So we honour and observe both of those truths in our receiving of these elements, which Jesus spoke of as representing his life, which we're invited to take within us. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks to the Father, and broke it. He gave the bread to his friends, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which will be given, broken, and raised for you. Do this in order to remember me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup of blessing, again gave thanks to the Father, gave it to his friends, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, the new relationship which God is making available to you in and through me. Every time you drink it, remember me." And so we remember Jesus. We make his presence in our world real as we allow his life to work through us to reach the people of our community in our generation. So we celebrate because all is prepared. Amen.
cross break of the energy.
The blood of Jesus, shed for us, keep us always in eternal life. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus and Jesus alone is our peace and God's offer of peace to a world which is chaotic without him. Enter then more deeply into the peace of Christ, and when you leave this place, take his peace with you. Not simply so that you can live in peace, but rather that living in his peace, you can share his peace with others. We go then in his name and for his kingdom's sake. Amen. Thank you. Our final song reminds us of the great truth that Jesus is always seeking to come. He's always seeking to make himself available to the men and women and boys and girls of the world today. Those whom God sees as his children, those who are made in his image and likeness. And so the necessity of preparing the way for his coming within our own lives and through our lives to the world around us continues as it ever has. And so these thoughts are celebrated in the words of our final song. These are the days of Elijah.
Thank you.
depress ourselves with the state of the world, which seems to get worse by the day. We should keep these things in context. We should keep these things in proportion by remembering that God has given us the answer to the problems of the world, and that answer is Jesus. Jesus is the one who reconciles to God, reconciles us to ourselves, and reconciles us to each other. I cannot think of a single problem in the world which would not be resolved if we allowed that reconciliation, those reconciliations, to take place. It is an all-encompassing offer by God to humanity. Teach us, good Lord, to serve thee as thou deservest, to give and not to count the cost, to fight and not to heed the wounds, to toil and not to seek for rest, to labour and not to ask for any reward other than the knowledge that we are doing your will. And in order that we might live our lives at this level, at the level of eternal life, life in all its fullness, we ask that all the resources of heaven be made available to us individually and collectively. So we pray this for ourselves and each other as we use the words of the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen and amen.